Good morning, folks. Thank you so much for joining us here at Ridgewood Live this amazing 20th day of September here in the year of 2020. It is a brisk day in the heart of the Arkansas Delta. It is all of 68 degrees here in Forest City, Arkansas, and it is absolutely amazing outside, and it is a good day to get out and to get to church. And we'd like to encourage you, you've still got time if you'd like to make your way out, and come on over and join us on campus as we get ready to worship and praise and to dive deeper into God's Word. When you get in and get on this morning, please say hello. Let us know that you're watching and let us know where you're watching from. We have lots of folks from all over the country that join us, and we would just like to say hello to you and to just find out a little bit about who all is actually joining us. If you are new to us, we would like to encourage you to get over to our website. That is lovemyrbc.com, and click on guest card, and just you take a couple of minutes and fill that out for us. Would you do that? We would so appreciate you taking care of that. It would be amazing. That way we can have a record of your attendance. We would love to know that. We have got folks beginning to pop on, and we thank you so very much. We are going to be spending some great time in worship this morning, and then I'm going to be diving way deep into the first four verses in Jonah chapter 4. So I want to encourage you even now to go ahead and get your Bible and go ahead and get it marked. That is going to be Jonah chapter 4 is where we're going to be camped out at tonight. If you are at home, if you're watching, please go ahead, get settled in, make sure you got a good cup of coffee, and grab a journal, because God is going to give us all kinds of good stuff today. I am going to get off here for about the next few minutes. I've got a couple of things I need to get wrapped up, and then it'll be start time at exactly 10:30. We love you guys so very much. Thank you for choosing Ridgewood as your place of worship, and we'll be talking with you soon. All right, folks, the countdown is here. We are just about ready to start. Thank you again for joining us. And when you get in, please say hello. Let us know who all is here. I see Mr. Lester Sales from Smyrna is hanging out with us. There's Miss Denny. Good morning, Miss Denny. Oh, yeah, we have got all kinds of folks in here. There's Kathy Stout. Good morning, Kathy. Mr. Rice, good morning, Mr. Bill. So glad that you are online with us, Mr. Bill. Thank you so much. There's Gina. Good morning, Gina. Glad, so glad that you are here. Thank you so very much. You see my mask? I've got my mask ready to go this morning. So let me get that thing turned right back around. There we go. All right. I'm going here. There's Bobby Aston. Good morning, Bobby. Glad to see you. Thank you for tuning in this morning and for joining us online. Folks, we're just about 2 minutes out, so I'm going to go ahead and get off and get ready to make my way toward the stage, and we will see you guys as soon as services are over. Please just be in prayer. It's going to be a great day, and I so pray that God speaks to you mightily through our morning service. Because I wanted to just publicly say thank you to him. He has blessed me with an LSU mask. And so for those of you who know me well, you know that this is a prized possession. And so I've already told Johnny, I think that it would be best if I lay that up there for him so that he can see this through all of the morning worship service. So John, if you're watching, if not, I'll talk to you this week. Thank you so much for taking care of me. Good morning, everybody. Good morning, and thank you for watching online. We're so glad that you are joining us. It is going to be a great day. Man, these guys had a tremendous practice this morning, and I cannot wait to just worship with everyone. If you are here, if you're watching online, we want to go ahead and get you to check in on Facebook. Go ahead and do that, and we want to get you to hit the share button. That is the way we just take it, a little farther, a little faster. So hit the share button. Let's get the broadcast out there this morning. Let's open with a word of prayer, and then our team's going to lead us in worship. Father, what a beautiful day. Father, what a cool, crisp morning you blessed us with here in the Delta. Father, we just pray, God, that you would just speak to us, Father, so cleanly, so clearly. Father, so powerfully. God, may all of our worship, Father, just be pleasing to your ear this morning. God, for those that are watching online with us, or those that will watch the rewind in the future, Father, I just pray a very special touch of your hand over each one. And Father, for our church family that is not here this morning for reasons only known to you, God, I pray a special blessing upon them. God, that you will watch over them, that you will protect them. Father, for those that are sick, you will be with our sick folks. For those that are traveling, you will just, Father, just wrap your hands around their vehicles. Father, we give this service to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Oh, some of y'all just got to sit down, but please stand. We're so few, you're going to need to be standing to hear you, I'm afraid. I don't want y'all to drown me out for sure. All get to heaven.
Bright and blessed, you prepare us a
know we're social distancing, but right now it looks like you're all social distancing from me and Margaret. And we'd be plenty close enough to you if you were on the front row. I mean, y'all have built on the back good. Bless you. Thank y'all for being here. Let's continue to sing. Darkness away, Jesus, my Savior, I live. whistle just a second. Songs that we lift up, you can hear our voice. More importantly than that, God, you can hear the voices going on inside us. The voices of thoughts that run through our brain and we don't voice openly. God, we pray all of that will be pleasing to you this morning. We know our pastor's about to come. We pray your blessing on him as he lift up your word to us and shares that with us. God, may it all collectively be a sweet sound to your ear. God, we thank you for the ability to be here this morning. I know there's some among us that are not. Others among us are not here as a means of caution, and we understand that. And God, there are so many needs around us. God, economically, socially, physically, you name it. Well, our most important need is spiritual, God. I'm convinced of that. God, I'm convinced that if we as a country will humble ourselves and pray and seek your face, then you promise to make all these other things go away. There are enough of them that we can get through it with a lot more pleasure anyway. God, again, we just thank you for the opportunity we have to be here, that you blessed us. It's not our goodness and mercy that's kept us here, God. It's not our goodness, excuse me, but it's your grace and mercy that we're all here this morning. Thank you. Praise you in Christ's name.
Amen. All right. We're going to be still camped out in Jonah, but this time we are going to crack open Jonah chapter 4. So I want to encourage you to go ahead and turn your Bibles on over there. Jonah chapter 4. We've got two more weeks, and we're going to wrap this up, and I do pray that God has used this to speak to you, that he has moved you through this powerful, small, prophetic book. Jonah chapter 4 is where we're going to be this morning. Let's listen to the phrase, or let's hear the phrase, and they lived happily ever after. And they lived happily ever after. See, that's the way we like our stories to end, from the youngest of the little guys and gals all the way up to the oldest of us in the room, and they lived happily ever after. I mean, when we think about it, we want good to be victorious over evil. We want the sick to be healed. We want the girl to get the guy or the guy to get the girl. We want the superhero to conquer the villain. We want Roy Rogers and Dale Evans to ride off very sweetly into the sunset. We like to see Marshall Dillon and Miss Kitty hanging out together and developing that romance that was there. And every one of us in the room can predict the ending to every Hallmark movie ever made. And they lived happily ever after. When we take that verse or that thought and we apply it to Jonah, it really looks good at this point where we ended last week. Jonah had finally obeyed God. He had went to that mighty capital of Assyria. He preached that powerful message of repentance that God wanted him to preach. And the whole blessed place broke out in repentance, from the king to the pauper. I'm talking the entire city received a massive outpouring of God's grace. Revival was taking place in Nineveh, the least likeliest of places on the planet. And when you begin to peel back verse by verse through these four chapters in the book of Jonah, in its entirety, it is, in all honesty, a textbook of God's grace. One of our favorite hymns that we've sang for years, that we teach our kids and we'll sing it till our dying days, is that precious hymn, Amazing Grace. How many of us really understand the words of that song? Amazing Grace. Sing that with me this morning. Amazing Grace. Come on, sing it. How sweet the sound. Sing it out. That saved what? A wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Let's look at that second verse this morning. 'Twas grace. Sing it out now. That taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the hour I first believed. From the very beginning, in chapter 1, all the way to the end of chapter 3, the pursuit of God's grace has been on full display, with its target being the very powerful city of Nineveh. And when we ended last week, at the end of chapter 3, God's grace had been poured out onto every person inside that great city. The hour I first believed was taking place literally and physically and spiritually in Nineveh. But now, as we take a step forward in chapter 4, to show us the vastness, the complexity of Almighty God, at the exact same time that he is pursuing the largest city on the globe, he is also pursuing one very lone and rebellious Israelite. Now you think about this. We saw God's grace pursuing Jonah through the storm, through the captain, through the sailors, and finally that great fish. And when we ended last Sunday, we were at Jonah chapter 3, verse 10. And I want to look at that this morning as we set the pace. Jonah chapter 3, verse 10 reads like this. Then God saw their works, that's their repentance, that they turned from their evil way. And God relented from the disaster that he had said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. We were at that happily ever after point. Story's over. Time to move on. Ready? Book's over. Put it in the shelf. But the book of Jonah doesn't end there, does it? It has a very different ending. Now, It's revelation time. See, in chapter 4, God is now realigning his sights, and he is aiming directly at this man called Jonah. In the fourth chapter, we're going to see God reveal a much greater problem that's located in the depths of Jonah's heart. It is revelation time. Read with me the very first four verses from the book of Jonah. But it displeased Jonah exceedingly, and he became angry. So he prayed to the Lord, and he said, "Ah, Lord, was not this what I said when I was still in my country? Therefore I fled previously to Tarshish, for I know that you are a gracious and merciful God, slow to anger and abundant in loving kindness, one who relents from doing harm. Therefore now, O Lord, please take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live." And the Lord said, "Is it right for you to be angry?" See, the first four verses of this chapter can be described as this: Jonah's resentment, God's restraint. Jonah's resentment, God's restraint. Since the beginning of chapter 1, Jonah has tried to create God in his image, and that is a God of vengeance. He wants to put God in this nice little box. Aren't you thankful that God doesn't fit in any of our boxes? He didn't fit in Jonah's. He doesn't fit in mine. He won't fit in yours. Even more thankful is that God doesn't give up on us when we try to put him in that box, does he? He just keeps on being God. And throughout this entire book, in the face of that unlimited, unwanted resentment from this prophet, we find the loving restraint of a loving God. See, one thing about Scripture is the fact that it's so raw, it's so real, that there's no sugarcoating on the lives of these believers, especially Jonah, who struggled with the complexities and the messinesses, the sins that's in their hearts. And guys, that should encourage us all. You see, I don't want us to fall into the trap that we think that all of the biblical characters that we find in Scripture are these perfect little men, perfect little women, that they've got everything working all the time for God, that they're always on fire for God, that they're witnessing every day, they're praying 5 to 6 hours a day, they're never struggling with sin. Because when you study anyone's life in Scripture really closely, you see that there are times when they are full of contradictions, but yet it is God's amazing grace that keeps them going. We saw God's grace pursuing Jonah throughout chapter 1. We saw God's grace capturing Jonah in chapter 2. And we saw God's grace give Jonah another chance, and that grace poured out and lavished upon the Ninevites in chapter 3. And then here in chapter 4, we're rolling up on a monumental temper tantrum. The truth is finally being revealed. Our grace, mine, yours, our grace, if you want to call it that, has limits. I mean, you think about it. We can only take so much, and then we reach our breaking points. But God's grace, amen? But God's grace is limitless. Even when he's pursuing a self-righteous, judgmental, religious prophet. Take this home with you today. God's capacity of grace is greater than our capacity to sin. If you don't take anything else home, take that. God's capacity of grace is greater than our capacity to sin. What really is the purpose of the pursuit of grace? Have you ever stopped to ask that question? Why does God pursue us with his grace? See, God extends his grace to us to reveal our deepest heart issues. And we look at that word extends, and it means to stretch out. It means to draw out to full length. And that's what he does with his grace to us. And the entire fourth chapter, and we've just read a slice of it this morning, but the entire chapter, and we'll see the rest next week, is all about God extending his grace. Now, sure, we've seen throughout these first three chapters, but now God's grace is about to be front and center. Have you ever thought about it? You and I draw the line as to how far God's grace can really go. Don't we? Well, you don't deserve it. Maybe you. You for sure. No way, you. Y'all ever done that? See, the thing is that when we do, God broadens it even further. God's grace doesn't just color between the lines. God's grace colors the whole page. If only that little narrow-minded, judgmental, racist, religious, angry prophet had gotten it. But he didn't. So revival is breaking out in Nineveh. Oh, that revival would break loose in the Arkansas Delta. Amen. Oh my. In Nineveh, people are repenting left and right, everyone from the king to the pauper. But have you realized something? We lost Jonah. In other words, from the fourth verse in chapter 3, when he stepped across the city limit sign and he preached that eight-word message that we have documented. Again, we know that it was larger than that. But from that point on, we don't see our boy Jonah. Where is he? Have you thought about it? Jonah preaches. Revival breaks loose. Verse 1, chapter 4. Let's read it again. But it displeased Jonah exceedingly, and he became angry. So now all of a sudden, the camera pans from that mass revival that's taking place in that great city, and it shifts, it pans over, and it refocuses on one person, that one little ticked off prophet that's, I can just imagine him sitting at the city gate. He's probably in a corner. He's probably got his arms crossed. He's looking down and smoke is coming out of his ears. Or maybe he's just stomping. He didn't get his way. You ever seen a kid just stomp off because they didn't get their way? I remember me doing it as a kid. Well, y'all? Kids, grandkids, that's Jonah. But he's doing it on a spiritual level. First word in that first verse, but. That little word means so very much. Because what this word, but, revealed is that everything that had just taken place, Jonah's preaching of the repentance, the whole Nineveh experiencing revival, experiencing the brokenness, all of it displeased Jonah. You see, in other words, it offended him. Does that sound familiar? It offended him. Things didn't go his way. And now he's throwing this monumental temper tantrum. See, the message that should be sent to Jonah and to all of these individuals and the various groups that are in America right now who are throwing temper tantrums because they're not getting their way should be simply this. Dear Jonah, or dear fill in the blank, or whatever group you want to talk about, or individual that you want to talk about, get over yourself. Amen? Wouldn't you like to tell that message to some of the groups you see on television that are out here just, well, that hurt my feelings. Get over yourself. And that should be the message that should have went to Jonah. See, God's anger had calmed down. But Jonas had just fired up. I mean, this dude was livid. He was livid. This verse, the very first verse, literally reads, but Jonah was deeply offended and he was burning hot. You combine the repentance of Nineveh and the gracious relenting of God, and you put that in the blender, that flipped Jonah's lid. He could not handle it. It was game over for Jonah. And in verse 2, Jonah prays instead of running like he did the first time. But notice, he is praying in anger. Look at verse 2. He says, so he prayed to the Lord, and he said, oh, Lord, was not this what I said when I was still in my country? In other words, I told you this. I told you this before. Therefore, this is the reason that I fled previously to Tarshish. Why? For I know that you are a gracious and merciful God. Well, that's a statement of faith. Amen? A statement of faith. He's admitting to God who God really is, but he don't like it. For I know that you are a gracious and merciful God, slow to anger and abundant loving kindness, one who relents from doing good. He is hot. See, Jonah considered what God did in forgiving the Ninevites and relenting from basically destroying them. Jonah considered that evil, and he considered that to be offensive. And so for one time right now, one time, we see Jonah's true feelings. They have just, the Band-Aid has been ripped off. And you see the wound. It is here, and he's praying about it. And in this prayer, he reveals why he took off for Tarshish in the first place. It's revelation time. I should have known it. I knew you was going to do this. Sounds like a kid, don't it? Sounds like a child. Sounds like an employee who didn't get their way at work. Amen? Oh, come on. See, Jonah knew that when God called him the first time to go to Nineveh, the capital of Israel's enemy, which was Assyria, that they deserved judgments. And I want us to understand perfectly who we're talking about here. The Assyrians were terrorists. They're still terrorists. Nothing's changed. Assyria was a terrorist nation, and it terrorized all of its neighbors. And Jonah knew that. Jonah and all of Israel wanted the Assyrians destroyed. And honestly, who in their right mind could blame them, right? If God had moved in destruction against the Assyrians, against those Ninevites, no one would have lost any sleep, because no one cries when the wicked gets their just rewards. And that is exactly what Jonah wanted. Now let's make it personal. I saw something on Twitter this past week. I can't quote it verbatim, but I can get real close. And the statement said this: let's make it perfectly clear that to God, all lives matter. Now I agree with that statement. But then he went on to say, except... sex traffickers, child abusers, murderers. All lives matter except. Is that found anywhere in this book? No. And now let's make it even more personal. Who seriously, whether you're in the room, whether you're watching online, who really was broken and who cried when Saddam Hussein was executed? Who got bent out of shape when the United States finally got their hands on Osama bin Laden? They deserve judgment. No, they deserve grace. The same grace that you and I get. Amen? But in preaching about God's judgment to the Ninevites, there was the possibility that they just might repent. It was a 50-50 call. And knowing God's character, Jonah knew that he would show them mercy when they did. Because instead of destroying the wicked, sometimes God redeems them. And Jonah didn't want anything to do with it. So he took off and jumped on a ship, headed to the farthest point away. Jonah could not stand the fact that God is a God of grace and God is a God of mercy. It eat him up. And when you think about it, this is a monumental statement of faith from Jonah. Now, who is Jonah? Who is Jonah? What can we compare him with? Who can we compare him to? He's like the older brother in the story of the prodigal son. The older brother didn't want that younger brother to get jacked when he came back. No. He is all of those religious snobs that's in the New Testament when we see that they loved grace for themselves, but they were unable to show grace to anyone else. He's anyone who wants things all to himself, and he wants to share them only with those who are just like him. You see, Jonah is you and me when we decide to get up on a self-righteous pedestal and we try to withhold the gospel of Jesus and the outpouring of God's grace on anyone that we don't like or who we don't think deserves it. That's Jonah. And then he makes this statement, and it's a quote in verse 2. You are a gracious and merciful God, slow to anger and abundant loving kindness, one who relents from doing harm. You know where he's quoting from? He is quoting from Exodus chapter 34, verse 6. It's a direct quote, and the irony here is amazing, because what he is doing is he's going back, and he is bringing into play now this conversation where God has saved Israel from Egypt. He miraculously delivered them from Pharaoh and the Egyptians through that Red Sea. We've studied that. He cared for them. He loved them. He provided for them. He delivered them. And how does Israel thank God? Do you remember that story? They all gather their jewelry and they make together a golden calf and they worship it, saying that this is the God that saved us. It's all in the 32nd chapter of Book of Exodus. But God, through Moses, God was ready to rip them. But because Moses pleaded with God, God forgives them, and he tells Moses to let the people of Israel experience God's character. This is who I am, says God. This is who I am. A gracious God and merciful, slow to anger and abundant in steadfast love. And Jonah's quoting this. The people of Israel owed their existence to the fact that God really was who he was, and he had spared them time and time again against the wrath and extended grace to them. Amen? All you got to do is just read the Old Testament and all the wilderness wandering. And what about Jonah? Why is he alive? He is alive because God was who he was and extended grace and mercy to him just as much. Oh, but no, not to Jonah. Grace and mercy has a limit. You see, Jonah doesn't like how undeserving grace is. He cannot accept a God who throws away grace just on any and everybody because they ask. And Jonah, just like Israel, does not admit how undeserving he was to receive it himself. And as a result, now we got a very extremist, self-righteous individual. He thinks God loves Israel because of who Israel is. And I think sometimes we as believers think that God loves us because of who we are, and that is wrong. God loves Israel because of who God is. And God loves you, Jonah, because of who God is. And he is a God of grace. And that is the same thing to you and to me. We put our name, and therefore, Jonah. God's agenda was not Jonah's agenda. And Jonah wanted no part of God's agenda. God's agenda was revival. And Jonah didn't want it. God's agenda was repentance. Jonah didn't want it. God's agenda was rejoicing, and Jonah wouldn't have it. Here he is, still trying to put him in that box, trying to squish him in, lock it, throw away the key, and God wasn't going to have anything to do with it. Jonah cannot stand a God that is so lavish with his grace and extravagant with his love. Jonah is angry because he cannot control God. And it is as clear as the black is on this white page in my Bible. Jonah resented God for being God. He resented God because God's grace to the Ninevites meant, you think about this, meant that the Ninevites were no different than Jonah was and the Israelites. It's like, oh no, we're up here and the Ninevites are down here. They don't deserve it. But when God showed them grace, oh look. Aren't you thankful for God's grace this morning? Man, Jonah thought that his people were better than the Ninevites and that they were more deserving of God's grace. And when that happens, when circumstances don't go our way the way that we had hoped for, what happens? Oh, we get mad and get pouty and want to go off in our own little way. Again, a current sign of the times of our culture and our society that's going on right here in our country. And all God's people said, amen. This is a crystal clear image of racism and elitism. Jonah's actions undoubtedly, unquestionably illustrate the insanity of racism. Have you noticed that Jonah never once says, I'm sorry, throughout this whole thing? And by the way, just as a FYI leading into next week, he never does. He doesn't say he's sorry because he feels totally justified. And now he probably feels more justified than ever because he was right about God. You see, it's almost as if Jonah is coming up to God and he's screaming, if I could do all of this all over again, I would do it again and I would run faster and farther than ever before because I don't want nothing to do with you being God. They don't deserve it and I'm not going to be a part of it. Because of racism, Jonah failed to see the glory of God in the diversity of redemption. And can I just be honest this morning? Because of racism, many times we fail to see the glory of God in the diversity of redemption. Because of racism, we fail to remember that we are all guilty before the standard of God. Romans 3:23 should be something that we all have memorized. What does it say? Paul says this, for all have sinned. Not some of us, not most of us. All. Amen? That's you. That's me. All. That's Jonah. That's Ninevites. That's everyone on the outside of these walls that has ever lived or ever will live. All have sinned. And we fall short of the glory of God. Verse 3. Back in Jonah chapter 4. Therefore now, this is Jonah still throwing his little hissy fit. Therefore now, O Lord, please take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live. For Jonah, dying is better than living, especially if the enemies are going to live and to get God's grace. He don't have anything to do with it. This is the second time that he asked to die. The funny thing is that he's so thankful that he didn't die back in Jonah chapter 2 that now that's all he wants, and that's just complete contradictions. Do you find it intriguing that God would even have this conversation with Jonah? Now you think about this. Why in the world would God even put up with that? Don't you want right now, okay, don't you want right now for God just to reach down and thump him right on top of his head? And then when he looks up, to thump him right on the nose. We want that, don't we? Come on. We want that. But God has this conversation. It tells me that God is never satisfied with compliance without conviction. See, just to make the statement, okay, God, I'll do what you want me to do, is just not enough. You've got to be in it from here. You've got to be in it from right here. God wants conviction from Jonah. He wants to take Jonah deeper with him, and God will never concede from doing that in our lives. He wants you and me to go deeper with him. And so what we see here in the midst of this temper tantrum, God responds with a question instead of that thump. I love it. Jonah, is this really necessary? Look at verse 4. Then the Lord said, is it right for you to be angry? Jonah, is this really necessary? Have you ever seen somebody probably at work or maybe in a classroom or something like that, maybe even your own kid, and I mean they were just throwing that temper tantrum and you just very calmly and very nonchalantly just walk up with them, you got a cup of coffee in your hands and you just kind of prop up on the kitchen counter and say, is this really necessary? You ever done that? Yes, we have. Is this really necessary? And that's exactly what God does. Put this in my notes. Ecclesiastes 3:20 tells us this. All are from the dust and all return to dust. Now we know that, right? To dust we're born, to dust we'll return, right? Right? Okay. My daddy always used to say, we're not going to die and then turn into something good to eat. It's just not going to happen. From dust we were born, to dust we'll return. You see, the thing is that Jonah thought that the Israelite dust was way better than the Ninevite dust. Maybe it had gold nuggets or something, I don't know. But Jonah, is this really necessary? Is it right for you to be angry? God does not scold him. Even when Jonah is this mad and is criticizing God, God doesn't come at Jonah with something like, well, who in the world do you think you are? Why are you talking to me that way? Do you know who I am? He doesn't do that. And neither does God turn his back on Jonah. So what is he doing? It's real simple. He's being true to his character. He's being true to his character, whether it is to a group of bloodthirsty Ninevites or to a sulking, angry religious prophet. I'm so thankful that God is the God that saved the Ninevites. He is the God who really had this conversation with Jonah, and he is the same God that saved me. Nothing's changed. And he won't change. He is extending his grace to show Jonah his deepest heart issues. And man, were they ever cleared. That same grace that had just been shown to that massive city of Nineveh was now being shown to this prophet. God's grace always goes farther than we can ever imagine and farther than we can ever expect. But Jonah just didn't get it. Jonah didn't get it because he was blinded by his own sin. Jonah didn't get it because he was blinded by his pure hatred for the Ninevites. Jonah was blinded by unadulterated racism. God is interested in our deepest heart issues. Y'all, we serve a God that is gracious. We serve a God that is merciful. We serve a God that is patient. We serve a God that is compassionate. We serve a God that is loving, and the list can go on and on. We like to treat the symptoms. God treats the cause. We like to use band-aids. God performs open heart surgery. God is not a makeup artist. If you put makeup on a pig, it's still a pig. Amen? Still a pig. Doesn't change. But what God is a master at covering our sins with his grace. Will you pray with me this morning? Father God, we love you so much. We thank you for your amazing grace. Grace that none of us deserve. Absolutely not a single one of us. Yet you love us enough to pour it out on us. And God, you poured out on men, women, boys, and girls, no matter where they live, no matter what their economic status is, no matter what the color of their skin is. You are God. Father, if there is anyone, Father, that is here, that is watching, or that will watch, Father, that is struggling with these issues, knows someone that is struggling with these issues, Father, may today be the day that you get a hold of us. God, that you call us out. That you reveal to us what really is buried in our hearts. God, we pray for revival. God, I pray for every living, breathing soul that's right here in this Arkansas Delta, Father, would just be drawn to you, and that you would reveal yourself to them as only you can, and only who you are, that God, they would realize the truth, and they would turn their life to you. Lord, let revival break loose today. Today. Don't wait another second, Father. We're praying for revival today. Move us, oh God, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Church, will you stand with us as we sing? Just as I am. God to make a difference in the Delta? Let me ask that again. Aren't you ready for God to make a difference in the Delta? Amen. It starts with me, and it starts with you. The sin of racism that has just absolutely consumed our country starts with Satan. In his lies. And we've got to acknowledge that. And folks, racism has to stop. Our country needs racism to come to a screeching halt today. It just has to. Make that a point of prayer going forward. Ask God to reveal to you ways that you can pray toward that. But racism has to stop. We're going to have a great week. Everything's back on track starting this week. Brother Larry will be in Zoom on Tuesday night. Miss Pat will be beginning her Sunday school lesson on spiritual warfare on Thursday, and our ladies' new Bible class will meet on Thursdays at 1 o'clock, and we want to encourage you to get in and get involved into all of that. If you're watching online or if you are unable to actually join us today, we want to just say thank you for being here. Thank you for for being a part of Ridgewood. And we want to also encourage you that if you have not sent in your tithes and offerings, we want you to do that. Mail them to here at the church, P.O. Box 785, 4 City, 72335, or you can go to the website, lovemyrbc.com, and click on online giving. And we certainly appreciate that and give you that opportunity to worship through giving. And as mentioned earlier in Sunday school, if you have not already given to Dixie Jackson, we want to encourage you to do that. We'll be taking that offering through the end of the month. We do have envelopes over on the tithing table, and you can just fill that out and drop that in the tote. That will be separate from your normal tithes and offerings. We are seeing tremendous work being done through the missions of Arkansas, as already been stated, and we want to continue to support that. God is good. Amen?
Amen.
All right, we're going to close in prayer, and then we will be dismissed. Let's pray. Father, we just give you this day. Father, we ask you to go with us, watch over us, protect us. Father, radically change our hearts to the gospel. Help us to be so fine-tuned to what you're doing, to what you're saying, that we absolutely cannot deny that it is the hand of God at work. And Father, we pray for the unequivocal end of racism. Let it start the end here. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Guys, y'all have a great afternoon. See y'all this week.
All right, folks, we just say thank you so much for tuning in with us today. It has been a pleasure to have you as part of our worshiping audience. If you have any questions, please make sure that you call the office Monday through Friday from 8:30 till 3:30. We would be glad to talk to you. That number is 633-1121. Thank you again. We love you guys so very much. Make sure to join me first thing in the morning, somewhere around that 8:30 time slot, for Monday morning coffee and Bible chat time. I look forward to seeing you. In the meantime, have a great day. Bye-bye, folks. We'll talk soon.